morning. Now is the time of the service when if anybody has any announcements for the life of the church, you are more than welcome to share those. Do we have things to add one?
Good morning, everyone. The church once again is sponsoring two children through Angel and Al. We have two siblings, a three-year-old girl and a four-year-old boy. I believe they're leaving from Conway, but I don't know exactly, but they're here in Valley. And there's a little tree outside the back door, and it has an item and what they're after, whether it's a winter coat or a toy or whatever. And if there's a list next to it, you can sign up for one and take the tag and then bring your item back no later than Sunday, December 8th. And there'll be a box there, and you can either have it wrapped or not, either way. Just great to support them. Thank you.
So angels and elves, which means that Christmas season is really upon us almost. And you're all welcome to take a tag and return it with the gift by December 8th. And the children, our education team, our children's education team is sponsoring this project this year. So the kids helped to decorate the tags this morning. And this is an education about, right, paying it forward and thinking about others at this time of year. Other announcements? Yeah.
With my treasurer's hat on, most of you should have received one of these either in your newsletter or in the mail. It's an indication of your giving for next year. We're in the process of finalizing the budget for 2020. And knowing what people think they might give, it's not a contract, it's not a hard commitment, but just an indication of what your giving might be, would be very helpful for us as we put together that budget. So if you don't have one, there's a couple up here on the little table, and there's a couple at the entryway. Please take one and just set it in the offering plate to let us know what you're thinking.
So you can see, Jeanette, if you have a question that this is about putting in a pledge if you're able. Our church usually ends up with a balanced budget by the end of the year, but because we don't always know what our cash in will be, as we begin the year, we project what our expenses are, and then sometimes we have to make a leap of faith and vote on the budget without knowing our full idea of cash flow. So if you make a pledge, you're basically helping us by telling us what you believe that you are able to contribute to the life of the church for the upcoming year. And then we're passing more or less a balanced budget as opposed to a deficit budget, which nobody likes to see, but we will do that if we have to. And every year, it comes out right, but only with your help. Thank you. Any other announcements? Oh, yeah, big one. Next Sunday is Brunch Church. It's our tradition for the last few years that we celebrate the Sunday before Thanksgiving by doing a potluck brunch. So please, if you're able, bring something. If you don't have time to cook, just show up. And we usually sit around tables together out back and eat, and we'll focus on the message of this Taste and See series by thinking about gratitude next week. We start in the sanctuary, so you can arrive here, drop off your potluck item, come to the sanctuary, and then go right back out back again and sit at tables together. There is also an ecumenical Thanksgiving service the same day, Sunday at 5:30 p.m. down at Tin Mountain Conservation Center. This is organized and led by the clergy of Valley. So several different churches and faith communities will be represented. And it's an interactive and fun way to just think about gratitude in the week preceding Thanksgiving. Other announcements. Alright. At this time, we're actually going to do November events. So if you've not had a chance to be here while we have been thinking about people that have died and gone ahead of us, we have a tree of life over here. There are little hearts, paper hearts. If you haven't had a chance to put somebody's name up already, please feel free to come up in the next few minutes while Alan is playing music, write their name, and then just clip it to one of the branches. Thank you. now I think you will all rise for the first song of the morning. Praise to the Lord the Almighty. Psalm 26 in the red here.
Thank you.
this time in the morning, we invite your prayers to be followed by a moment of silence, and then we'll join together in the Lord's Prayer. We begin with those prayer requests that come from the 8 o'clock gathering. For Frank, who is living with esophageal cancer and is about to have some imaging done to see where the progress in recovery or treatment may lie. For Kenny, a friend who is in ICU with multiple complications. For Sasha Tracy's new baby who is about to be born in this village. For Bob Davis, who died last week. For B, who loves him and kept him at home till almost the last day of his life. And for all those who have been touched and changed by Bob's presence in this valley and in this village. For the city of Hong Kong, caught in the tension between different agendas and needs, her people, her way of governance, and her way of life at risk. We are all watching and hoping. Are there other prayers of concern at this time?
For a new friend, Kara, her daughter is was diagnosed with a rare form of cancer, and she is asking for prayers for her daughter.
For Carol and her daughter, who is living with a rare form of cancer. Any other prayers?
For dear friend Reverend Carol, who is dealing with the last attempts to overcome stage 4 lung cancer.
For dear friend Reverend Carol, is that right? Who is in last attempts to grapple with stage 4 lung cancer.
My best friend, Stuart, who just found out that he has bladder cancer.
For Jim's best friend, Stuart, living with bladder cancer. We also hold up hope when we do these prayers because we carry a lot of heavy things into this space, and so we need the hope that comes with it. Later I'm going to tell you a story about a butternut tree. But there's gratitude for a butternut tree. And the 8 o'clock said they were grateful for their dogs who alert them to the world by either going out on a walk or barking at night and chasing things like planes and wildlife. Gratitude for the full moon of this past week and the light has been shining at night. For the snow casting light into people's homes in a different way. For the owls that were at Tin Mountain on Saturday. For red and gray fox that is spotted on the land, and for the tracks of the following animals, coyote, bobcat, voles, mice, and turkeys. And thank you for the juncos that we have been seeing in the trees of late because our winter birds have returned. And maybe even gratitude for the rare sighting of a bear, they are still out and about. Are there other moments of gratitude that creation or people have brought to you? Lori?
Well, I was walking behind the snow plate yesterday with my dog, and often I do that. And I looked at a pond, and about 4 or 5 days earlier, I saw a merganser duck, a little one. And I wanted to go rescue it because I knew it hadn't missed the boat myself. So yesterday, as I'm walking by, I look, and all of a sudden, I see this large, dark form over there by the opening, by the water closing. And I yelled out, I said, you're supposed to go home. And his head lifts. And I think it was an otter. And he jumped in the water and swam in. I've never seen an otter in that pond. Maybe he escaped from
the So prayers that the merganser duck will find its way to safety and warmth. And prayers of gratitude for the otter that's still hanging. Any other prayers? Please join me in prayer. O Holy One, who is with us to comfort and guide us and inspire us, to heal us make us curious, to call us to acts of justice and creativity. We have prayed out loud just a few names of places that are in tension and conflict, and we know there are so many others, including within our own nation. And we have named those people who need your healing and your comfort. And yet we know that they are only a few examples of those that live with life-changing, life-altering, or life-limiting conditions. And so for those who live with changes in cognition, changes in their body, sudden or long-lasting, people who are in transition, and for those who love them and vigil with them, for the lives that have been long and storied or short and too brief and so bright, and those who have gone ahead of us, we give gratitude and we ask for comfort, resilience, stability, patience, humor, and love where it is needed. We give thanks for the life of a new baby about to be born and a grandchild already recently born. Congratulations, Grandpa Mom. And for birthdays and anniversaries and the commitments that we make to each other. In all the ways that we live our lives, aware of love's presence, we give thanks. Hear us now in our silence. And listen as we pray to you, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil, for thine is the kingdom.
Body as he has chosen, and to each kind of seed his own body. Next one is Peter. You have been born anew, not of perishable, but of imperishable seed, through the living and enduring word of God. Esdras. Okay. O Lord, above us, grant to your servant that we may pray before you, and give us a seed for our heart and cultivation of our understanding, so that fruit may be produced, by which every mortal who bears the likeness of a human being may be able to live. That's
all. Thank you. So today we're going to recap the different things that we have focused on in our Taste and See series, and I believe I might need some help. Would you guys come help me? So up here on the left-hand side of the dais, we've been having a display of the life of the different symbols of the Taste and See series. And we've been studying different foods of the Bible and how to eat God through butchered makers and fresh food makers and the elements of the Bible. And you'll see some symbols here, but we're going to remind you about our symbols and ask that will help us think about what we talked about over the last several weeks. The first one was actually red. Can you guys put that somewhere up there? And I would ask all of you to help us think about what did Mary Beads talk with us about on World Communion Sunday, and what does bread symbolize to us as a food? You ready? Whatever comes to mind, it doesn't have to be what Mary said, it can be whatever you know it to symbolize. We can start with communion as a little hint. Bread of life. Yes, bread of life, right? So all throughout the Bible, we talk about manna, we talk about bread being sent and being available to people, and it is the symbol of a life being broken open and shared with us, and it is the place where we meet and we create peace and relationship when we sit down together to share a beverage, and a loaf of bread or some other kind of food. So there's pretzel sticks up here on the altar as our final form of bread. And our next symbol was... Let's see if they can guess this. Can you hold that up? Where's that from? This one's a stretch. You have to kind of stretch for this one. What is this? Does anybody know what this is? The conch shell. All right, so where is it from?
The
ocean. So what might the food be that goes, oh, fish, yes. All right, fish. All right, good job. Do you want to put that up there somewhere? All right, so what did fish mean to us when we talked about fish and our relationship to Christ, to God, to creation? You guys are really quiet today. You were... yeah, well, that will come later. What do you think of that? Okay, but, yeah, go for it.
Well, Jesus handed out the loaves and the fishes. They were a few. So it symbolizes things like faith, multiplying.
Okay, so multiplying faith.
The goodness that we can give our little help turns into huge amounts.
Okay. All right, so Meg remembers the story that over and over again, Christ broke and shared loaves and fishes and made much out of little, right? What else? Who were the people that followed Christ? Fishermen, right? So there's stories about fishermen who left their trades behind and followed Christ in the way of peace and change-making. He didn't pick princes and judges and warriors. He chose fishermen and then other simple people and called them into a different way of life. So fish has a promise of abundance for us and connection for us. All right, this one's really a stretch because this isn't even the right fruit, but we're going to see if you guys can remember. There was a piece of fruit, and it wasn't an apple. Who remembers what might have been the... Oh, good memories. So it's possible that the first fruit that was ever written about, the one that was eaten in the Garden of Eden, was a fig. Because the oldest fruit that was ever cultivated by humanity was the fig. And repeatedly, all throughout the scriptures, the Hebrew scriptures and the gospel, the image of the vineyard and the fig tree and the ones who will create peace and live in abundance and prosperity together is under the fig tree and in their own vineyard. It is a promise of what is possible when we live in community together. We're stretching for ourselves. So the next one, you guys might have a hard time guessing what this is, but let's see if anybody remembers. This one's really heavy. You ready? Can you hold that way up over your head? Does anybody? Salt. This is probably salt that was mined in the Himalayas, from the mountains, and there were lots of ways that you could get salt, but what does salt have to tell us? Flavoring? Preservative? In the early scriptures, it was even an element that had to be present to bind covenants because it represented preservative, endurance, the stability, and long-lasting relationship between God and God's people. And it was also used as a fertilizer in the fields. And so salt present in the fields, in great quantity could destroy the fields, but in smaller quantities actually made them more nutritious and help the earth continue to bear life. All right. This one's a stretch, too. You want to hold that one? I bet David knows what this is a symbol for. Can you hold it up? What is this a symbol for, do you think?
Shepherds.
The lamb and the sheep. Yeah. This is a ram's horn. This is not the one that I tried to play before, and I'm not trying to play it today. This one's even harder to play than the other one. So, sheep, and the symbolism of sheep throughout, again, the Bible. They're present as livestock. But we have these conflicting images of Christ's self as both lamb and shepherd. The one who gives himself, who puts himself in harm's way and offers all for the sake of those that he loves, and yet is also the image of the one who guides and makes decisions and leads the way and creates a way that we can walk together. You already see the beautiful skeins of wool that are up there. Now, what do you think is on her head?
Olive.
Olive, that's right. So the olive branches were used to crown people at the ends of things like races. And they were used as that tension right there on our great seal, the olive branch with the 13 leaves. It's a symbol of enduring peace, even in the midst of conflict, because even those who are defending us wage peace first. And as we learned last week in the conversations with the women that came out from Boston, that is the call of Christ in our lives, to wage peace, and to wage it courageously and actively. Thank you, ladies. Please pray with me. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable to you, our Rock, today we focused on seeds and spices, but you will have heard that largely we're focusing on the mustard seed. And in contrast to the spices that are present throughout the scriptures, the ones that are traded and carried to be gifts for a king, and are even used in the preparation of a body at the end of life, including Christ's own body at the end of his life, spices were precious. They were carried along a trade route, and their origins were closely guarded. Scary stories were told about those trade routes to keep others from following them and discovering them. They were essential to the life of the people in those lands. They helped to preserve food. They were, again, they were like salt. They weren't just to spice things up. They helped to preserve food in places where food could easily go bad. They were used on bodies for medicinal purposes. They had great value. They were used as a form of currency. And then there's the mustard seed. Today we think about mustard as something that we put on our hot dogs. We think about it as a food that we eat. And you can see fields full of cultivated mustard in France, in the United States, all over the place. Beautiful, blossoming yellow plants. But because we don't always live close to the land, we've forgotten that the mustard seed in the story that Christ was telling is not a welcome presence. It's a weed. And not only is it a weed, it's kind of like kudzu vines down south. Introduced for all the right reasons, and then they run rampant, and they're everywhere, and they are your worst nightmare when you're trying to grow something else. This is what a mustard seed is like. Oh, we need your help again, ladies. How big do you think a mustard seed is? Some of you who are cooks probably already know the answer to this. How big do you think they are? So big, you guys. When you pass these around, everybody gets a mustard seed. Go down the aisle. And take one each and hold it in your hand so you can see how small is the idea that was being planted in those stories. It's hard to even grab just one. The farmers back in Jesus' day would be really mad that we were passing out these seeds, by the way. There are two famous stories about mustard seeds, and I wonder if anybody can shout out what they remember about mustard seeds. When they think the size of a mustard seed, you can move mountains, and nothing is impossible for you. And in the parable that Christ was telling about the mustard seed, he compared the kingdom of God here on earth to a mustard seed. So what's that little tiny thing in your hand? That's the kingdom of God. How is something so tiny the kingdom of God? Because from that tiny beginning, grow something that can be tall enough and strong enough for life to find sanctuary, for branches to flourish, to become the home of birds of the air, a place where a nest can be built or a flock can roost and sing to you. And even more remarkably than that, because it's an unwelcome weed, it's busy growing in places that you didn't expect it. Its roots are going out, shooting under the ground, even when you're not watching. And they're coming up. And they're big, and they're thirsty, and they're resilient, and they're going to be everywhere. How many of you gardening have ever left something in a part of the ground, and it suddenly took off and took over something? Yeah, okay, now it's starting to get some hands. What did you plant that took over something else?
It was gout weed.
Gout weed. What about over here?
Bamboo.
Bamboo?
Morning glory.
Morning glory.
Mint.
Mint. Yeah. Meg, what was yours? What did you plant, Meg? Do you remember?
It was a bush that a neighbor said, oh, would you like a piece of this? And I'll say, I don't want to get tired of that.
It was a bush that they can't get rid of.
But,
and over here I saw a hand. Who planted something over here that took over?
Pragmites.
Pragmites, okay. Lots and lots of different things that are willing to take over your garden. Well, mustard is among them. So why would Christ compare the kingdom of heaven instead of to, you know, like the vineyard, which he did in other stories, or all these helpful plants? Why would he compare it to something like a kudzu vine? Or a mint, which might be tasty, but, you know, it's just taking over everything. Why? Because the way that he viewed the world was different than the people around him. He was overturning expectations and traditions and ways of life and perceptions and even positions of power. The kingdom of heaven on earth, not the kingdom of heaven in heaven, not the kingdom of heaven at the end of our lives when we die and we go up to the clouds and the angels and God seated on the throne or whatever we think heaven is like. The kingdom of heaven here. That's what is like a mustard seed that becomes a plant that bears fruit and life and becomes a sanctuary and is undeniable. What is the kingdom of heaven? It is justice for all people. It is the capacity to be able to offer the peace of the olive branch and make the promise of the salt covenant and to know that you can sit safely under your own fig tree with your own bonds, because you are connected to a community that acknowledges who you are, the importance of your life, that you are sacred, and that within you, like within the fig, lie the seeds of future generations. Whole communities and villages are carried in every seed, every tree, every person that walks this earth. He chose an image that was surprising because you had to look differently at it to think this is valuable, that this unexpected, unwelcome presence is going to change my life in ways that I didn't want it to change. It is going to overturn power structures and ways of being that are uncomfortable and will take apart everything that we thought we knew and remake it in a new way. And yet from that beginning will come life and possibility and generations who are still gathering to tell these stories and believe in the power of love as a transformative presence in the world, walking and growing even now. From the seed of one man's life and the seeds that had been sown into him by all the teachers that taught him the Hebrew scriptures, that he passed along and lived. Come all the ways that we live as people of faith even now. The mustard seed was so small, it could have ended with the life of one man. The story might have stopped there, but he had followers. And they went out and they told those stories and they lived that faith and that belief themselves. And they too became both lamb and shepherd, and they gave their lives. They committed themselves to what they believed in, that others might have the chance to hear and see and believe as well. We talked about this morning with girls, examples of people that have cultivated a small beginning into something that changes the world. Lori Kinsey from Tin Mountain talked about the butternut tree on the property at Tin Mountain. It drops these great hard nuts that are encased in a really hard shell and have to use a hammer to get them open. But They're kind of like walnuts, but different. And they don't grow easily in this climate, but they will grow. And she kept going out and trying to harvest the crop of nuts that was falling off the butternut tree, and they were all just gone. And she's like, where are all those butternuts going? And it wasn't the squirrels that were taking them all. It turned out to be a man who works for the electric company and drives by all the time. And he saw all the butternuts, and he would collect them. And she was a little annoyed until she found out that he's sort of like the Johnny Appleseed of butternuts. So I guess you'd call him Johnny Butternut. He takes the nuts all over New Hampshire and he plants them. And so there are butternut trees wherever they have taken root and thrived all over New Hampshire that came from the tree at Tin Mountain. One man just picked that as the way that he would help change the world in his daily living. You guys remember the lady from Maine, right? Lupin? The lupinate, right? The one who's famous for planting those beautiful purple flowers all up and down the roadways and the fields and the paths of Maine, because that was how she could change the world. And there's a woman who won a Nobel Peace Prize for planting trees, Wangari. I've told you her story before. She lived in Kenya. And her land had been decimated by different kinds of development. And the trees that were indigenous to her land that were so important to every single village had disappeared. And so her beginning, it's the size of a mustard seed in your hand, was to plant one tree, and then another tree, and then another tree, all over her country to restore the landscape, the environment, and the way of life that was being lost. To restore a culture, and to be in connection with creation in a sustainable way again. She created the Green Movement, the Green Belt Movement. And she won a Peace Prize for her work, planting trees in her own nation. But there are so many other things that can grow. Ideas can take shape and fly from person to person. When you teach a woman to read in a place, right, like Ray Mortensen said, you teach a village to read and a community to read. When you change the rights, the education, the life of one person in a place where they will stay and share it with others, or allow them to travel and go somewhere else and share their ideas and raise up their voice, the kingdom of God is moving in that life. The kingdom of God moves one life at a time, one seed at a time, and it is in you. You are like the fig or the mustard seed that is blown. And within you thrives the love and the possibility of transformation, not just for yourself, but for every life that you touch. Bob Davis, who died just this week, was a farmer. He was a man of very few words. He loved John Wayne and Marilyn Monroe. He wasn't known for being the friendliest of people all the time, although he gave 55 years of service as a firefighter and 44 as a firewarden to this town. But what people say he will be remembered for is the way of life that he led. He lived close to the earth. And one person at a time, he taught people the art of farming. And how to live here in these mountains close to nature, hunting, fishing, logging, and farming. Sometimes our legacies are not measured in words. They are measured in the way we live our lives and the lives that we touch and change just by being who we are and living true to what we believe. The kingdom of God here on earth, the kingdom of heaven, of love, compassion, and justice rests in you, in all that you do and believe and how you choose to live your lives. And it is passed down to the next generation, and the next generation, and the next generation. Thanks be to God. and Nazareth. May the blessings that have come into your life be planted here to take root and grow in the ways that they might grow to become shelter, safety, and hope for others, rising up.
Thank you.
change in your heart and a song of hope and peace in your life. Amen.
Amen.